ओमज्ञात विरंदस्य ज्ञानांजन शलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। सो आई एम ग्रेटफुल टू बी हियर विथ यू टुडे एंड वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग बेस्ड ऑन दिस वर्स अ वेरी कंटेम्पररी काइंड ऑफ टॉपिक। सो वाज वैदिक कल्चर अगेंस्ट इंटरकास्ट और इंटरग्रुप मैरिजेस। Here, in this particular verse, Maharaj Puru is seeing this, Maharaj Dushmant, the King Dushmant is seeing this beautiful girl and he feels attracted to her. And she's in the forest. And he makes this remarkable claim. So the theme which we'll be discussing is how regulation of desires can seem repressive, but it isn't actually repressive. So when he sees her, this is the verse. व्यक्तम राजन्य तनयाम वेद्म्यहम त्वाम सुमध्यमे नहि चेतः पौरवाणाम अधर्मे रमते क्वचेत। सो व्यक्तम राजन्य तनयाम, सो आई फील दैट यू मस्ट बी राजन्य तनयाम, दैट मीन्स यू मस्ट बी द डॉटर ऑफ अ किंग, someone related with the king, a kshatriya, or someone raj anya, someone connected with a kshatriya. Although she is in a forest, and it could be intuited that she is the daughter of a sage living in the forest, which would mean she is a brahmani. But he's saying, no, I suspect, I think, vedmyaham tvam sumadhyame. So in the Vedic tradition, there are different ways of appreciating. So for example, men are considered attractive when, say, they are broad-shouldered. So females are considered attractive when they are sumadhyame, that the it refers to the physical beauty of the women. So nahi chetah pauravanam. So he says further, you are attractive, and he's describing the attractiveness, but he's saying further, nahi chetah pauravanam, that I am a descendant of the Puru dynasty. And the consciousness of a king in the Puru dynasty, adharme ramate kvachit nahi, it will not delight in adharma. The consciousness of the mind will not delight in adharma. So what is the adharma over here? He is not saying that, okay, I find you attractive, that itself is adharmic. But he's saying that as a kshatriya, I am trained to respect brahmanas. And a brahmana's daughter is like a guru's daughter. He says she is to be respected. So he's saying that I won't feel attracted to you if you were a brahmani. So therefore, since I feel attracted to you, you must be a kshatrani. You must be the daughter of a kshatriya, not the daughter of a brahmana. So please tell me who you are. So this is a remarkable verse. So if we consider the implication, what he's saying is that his Dushmant is making this remarkable claim that the very fact that he feels attracted to a woman indicates that she must be a kshatriya. She was a daughter of a kshatriya, kshatriya member, basically. So what is the rationale for his reasoning? He's saying that because my mind is trained and my mind won't seek irreligious enjoyment. Na adharme ramate kvachit. It won't delight in adharma. So this seems to say that the male-female attraction itself is not adharmic. It's just a part of human existence. And it's, in one sense, necessary biologically for procreation and the continuance of the human race. And he says, it is adharmic when he's saying it is directed toward the improper person. So, for example, in today's world, or at least in where traditional morality is present, if a person is married and they feel attracted towards somebody who is other than their marital partner, then they know that this is improper. I need to regulate it. So he's saying that for me to be attracted to somebody who is not from my varana, who is not a kshatriya, that would be inappropriate. And my mind is trained to not have such inappropriate attractions. So that seems a remarkable claim. What is this rationale? So now, why is this claim so remarkable? Because especially in our times, there are these common misconceptions about male-female attraction, which we call as love. So we say love is blind. So love is blind means what? That love, you know, once we get attracted to a particular person, it only sees that person and doesn't see anything else connected with that person. So or we say love just happens. Or sometimes we say we fall in love. Now when we say we fall in love, it's almost as if, suppose I'm walking somewhere and I fall into a ditch or I step on a banana peel and I fall. Normally when we talk about falling, it's as if there's nothing in our control in that context. So is it like that? Is it really that when we feel attracted to someone, there's nothing in our control, it just happens and it takes away our rationality, it even takes away our volition, our free will, it's just something which comes from beyond us and overpowers us? Well, this can happen to some people and it happens to many people, but it doesn't have to be always like that. It doesn't have to be always like that, that the attraction is going to overpower someone. And he is talking about his training as a Kshatriya, his training as a cultured member of an illustrious dynasty. And he's saying that this won't happen to me. Now, moving forward, so he's saying he's making a personal claim. He's not making a universal claim over here. He is not saying that nobody ever will be attracted to anybody from some other Varana. He's saying my mind is trained in such a way that it won't be attracted. So there are examples in the Vedic tradition that we call as Anulom and Pratilom marriages. So when a Brahmana man might marry a Kshatriya woman, or a Kshatriya man would marry a Brahmana woman. So broadly speaking, he is not saying that this can never happen, and he's not saying that that is condemned. It is possible that such marriages can also happen and they can also work. Suta Goswami himself, who is one of the narrators of the Srimad Bhagavatam, is from one such marriage. And yet he is himself an exalted sage. So if we consider the success of one parameter of success of marriages, in what kind of children come from that marriage, then it's not that this is a condemned thing. It is not something which is to be rejected. But he's saying that, you know, my training will make it not happen for me. So is this a statement that it means that intercaste relationships are to be condemned? Well, it is not out of, first of all, although this statement does put intercaste relationships, especially marital relationships, in an unfavorable light, it doesn't stem from an inherent bias against any particular caste. Why is that? Because in this case, at least, Kshatriyas always respected Brahmanas. If the Brahmana would come to them, they would offer respect and an honorable seat, especially if there's illustrious sages, and wash their feet and when respect, worship them even as representatives of God. So it is not due to bias against any particular castes, but the purpose was that when people were born in the similar caste or in the same caste, then that what would that would mean is that they had similar family cultures, they had similar upbringing, they lived in more or less similar community. And then that was a reasonable parameter for inferring like-mindedness or compatibility among prospective partners. So the point is not a rigid fencing off of relationships beyond the same caste. But the point is that forming a lifelong relationship is always a challenge. And nowadays there is a lot of concern, and it has always been there to some extent, about compatibility. So one way in which we can never guarantee, that's why I said it is a reasonable assurance, it's not a definitely 100% guarantee, that How do we know that there'll be some amount of compatibility? If both have grown up in similar situations, they share similar values, they share similar worldviews, they share similar life purposes, then that is a reasonable parameter, reasonable basis. So rather than seeing this as a restriction or as a ban against relationships outside one's particular social grouping, we can focus more on the principle. So last, we have also discussed that caste was not just determined by birth. Caste was determined by qualities. So if caste is also determined by qualities, then if we say that there are two people with similar psychophysical nature, similar dispositions, then the possibility of they having a healthy relationship, a sustainable relationship, relationship fraught with less difficulties is more likely. So it's not due to bias or narrow-mindedness. It is the social arrangement for facilitating compatible relationships. And that's why we have to see, is it restrictive? It is not restrictive, but it's supportive. So in today's world, people say, you know, anybody can marry anyone if they're attracted and if they want to be together. Why should anybody else come in the way of that? Yeah, that is one way of looking at things. And we may consider today the reluctance to normalize marriages across groups. You know, it's just today's concern, normal. What's the issue? If you are from a different religion, you are from a different this, you are from different that, what's the big issue? And anybody who seems to make it an issue, we may consider them too restrictive or regressive or old-fashioned. Yes, that restrictiveness, it may seem to us like that. But the point is, this overall social orientation toward marrying people within the same social group, it was supportive for people, not restrictive. Supportive for what? For finding a reasonably compatible partner and getting along with that partner and getting on with the business of life. Getting on with the business of life. Now, what do we mean by the business of life? That life involves facing various challenges at a material level. Life itself is tough. The world gives us many, many challenges and distresses in different ways. And primarily, we need to get on with the business of life. We live at a material level. We need to survive and function at a basic level. And then we want to go further and do something meaningful with our life. Now, what is meaningful? We understand through the spiritual texts that ultimately realizing our spirituality is meaningful. So getting on with the business of life is important. And it was a supportive arrangement for that. I'll explain this concept of the business of life a little bit more. So if we consider what is the business of life, So if we consider today's postmodern ideas, and that too it is a radical postmodern idea, the purpose of life is to, the business of life is to express our autonomy and express our individuality. This is who I am. And the whole world has to change to accommodate who I am. So if I have a particular identity, say for example, now there is a certain level of insistence that people have their own preferred pronouns. And that others should address me by this particular pronoun. There is also attempts to make that a law, that if you don't address me by my preferred pronoun, then you can be legally fined for that. So now, yes, we all have a certain level of autonomy and individuality, and that needs to be expressed. It can't be suppressed. But is that the purpose of life? At expressing our autonomy and individuality, that is not even a modern, it's a radical postmodern concept. And I'll discuss a little bit what are the challenges with that. But the purpose of life, it's just to be yourself. I just want to express myself. Be yourself. That is the idea. And if we consider the business of life, if we look at a pre-modern tradition, there was a rigid conception. Now, when I'm talking about pre-modern, I'm not necessarily talking about what was spiritual, because what was spiritual was also lost over time in recent history, recent pre-modern history. Across the world, whether it is India or the West, religions had in many ways become fossilized. They had become quite rigid. So the rigid pre-modern concept was that training oneself for conformity to do one's duty. That, you know, you have your duty and, you know, okay, you are born in this family, therefore you have to marry this person and this is your duty. You know, honor your dynasty, obey your parents, or do this or do that. So for example, in the past, we see that when it, especially among kings and royalty in general, the extended family of the king, marriages were often not just interpersonal relationships, they were political alliances. So the people involved, their desires were subordinated to other purposes. So, and they were told that you have your duty, this is what you have to do. So we could say that the duty to society, duty to one's dynasty, duty to one's community or whatever, that was considered to be the primary purpose. And you have to conform to whatever your duty requires. So is it the business of life to express our individuality? Is it a business of our life to conform to our duty? Now, of course, we all have certain duties, certain responsibilities in life. But sometimes conformity can kill individuality. And when that starts happening, so for example, even the caste system, it became repressive when conformity was imposed based on birth. You are born in this varna, this is who you are, and you don't even dare to do anything else. So conformity can come in various ways. So both these, the postmodern idea, which is in some ways radical, and the pre-modern idea that which was quite rigid, both of them in some ways get it wrong. They are both extremes. So in between, what do we have? The business of life, that is, it's based on spiritual wisdom. And it's not just spiritual wisdom, but a harmonious application of spiritual wisdom. What is that harmonious application? That our personal autonomy has its role. Our social duty has its role. But both of them need to be utilized for the purpose of realizing our spirituality. And of course, there are others in society, and they are also meant to be encouraged for realizing their spirituality. So that is overall the purpose of life. The Bhagavatam explains that Tattva Jigyasa or Brahma Jigyasa. We have to realize who we are, realize whose we are, what is our essential identity. That is the purpose of life. So now, with this understanding of the purpose of life, so if we consider applying this whole thing to the idea of relationships and especially marriage, so when it's a postmodern concept, what happens is, it's my autonomy, it's my choice, I will marry whoever I want, and whether it is from a different social group, different country, different language, different religion, or even that person may be from the same gender that I belong to, whatever. So it's all about expressing one's autonomy. Now, I'm not saying any of this is necessarily wrong. I'm just explaining how this applies to this particular discussion of the business of life, can apply in this context. So on the other hand, the traditional idea we could say is that, you know, this is what your parents want, this is what your family want, this is what your elders want, this is what you have to do. You just marry and don't consider anything else or anyone else. So we could say this is in some ways a discussion between love marriages and arranged marriages. Now, I don't somehow like this polarization that love marriages and arranged marriages. So is it that in arranged marriages there can never be any love? And is it in love marriages there are no arrangements? Nowadays, what to speak of some arrangements, many times when people have love marriages, they often have prenuptial arrangements about if we separate, you know, who will get what property and things like that. So isn't that a big arrangement in some ways? Who will share property and things like that? So it's the terminology itself is misleading, because it's a polarizing terminology that it's as if arranged marriages are inherently against love. That's not the point. That's not their purpose at all. So overall, the point which I'm making is that we live in a world which is highly in flux, especially in the Western world. Arranged marriages are hardly there at all. In India also, they are there to some extent, but it is also decreased in this one generation, and it is decreasing further. So if we consider the idea of conformity, I explained that everything, oh, you're just told you have to marry this person. Won't it be repressive? I'll be miserable throughout my life. But actually, rather, is it that people in the past were all very miserable because they were just told whom to marry? That's what we may feel. So we may believe that people must have felt repressed. And why is that? Because now it's not necessarily true, because with the focus nowadays on autonomy and individualism and in self-expression, people in the past didn't have that. So nowadays, marriage is seen like an option. Whereas in the past, marriage was seen as an obligation. And yes, nobody wanted an unhappy marriage. Nobody wanted a terribly incompatible marriage. Obviously not. But the whole idea that the whole of reality needs to be rearranged in a way that it facilitates my individuality, my autonomy. That kind of idea was hardly there in the past. So we find it repressive. And yes, if it is implemented literally in today's world, we will feel it. We will be repressed. But we needn't think that people in the past who lived in such an arrangement had to live tormented lives. Often when people write historical fiction or they make movies which are period dramas, then there is always this temptation to project modern values into traditional stories. And then try to retell those stories or distort those stories or question those stories. So we don't have to impose our values, our emphasis on autonomy in traditional stories. Now, if we consider, say, Shakespeare's play like The Taming of a Shrew. Now, from today's perspective, it can seem outrageous. So basically, the idea of calling a woman itself a shrew and thinking of taming her like an animal. From the name itself, there are some aggressive feminists who have objection to that. But if we look at what Shakespeare is telling, at the end of it, the female lead, she's happy. And they are happy at the end of the marriage. Now, we may say, oh, this is Shakespeare wrote it. He wrote it like that because he was a man and he wanted women to be subordinate. Well, we don't hear of any such condemnation of the Taming of Shrew from the time of people at that time. So I'm not saying that that is what is to be done today. All that I'm saying is that evaluating everything of the past from today's values, that is what we are. It's almost like historical imperialism. That means we stand at the summit of history and we are going to judge everything, all other times in history, from a superior perspective. So now this, of course, literally repeating this in today's world is going to be a problem. Even in our movement, when initially Srila Prabhupada and some of Srila Prabhupada's disciples, they just tried to tell, no, okay, you marry this person. And that kind of arrangement, it didn't work. Because we have been brought up in a culture where autonomy is important for us. And so I'm not saying that we have to go turn the clock back. I'm just saying that we don't have to reject or condemn the past based on the values that we have consciously or unconsciously internalized today. So moving forward, now if we consider, that's why we need to. So we may say, oh, the past was all repressive and terrible. But okay. But is it that the present is wonderful? Is it okay? You may say arranged marriages were very repressive, but is it that love marriages are working wonderfully? Well, it's not true. Contemporary marriages aren't working too well. Now we can say there are many factors for that. And I'm again not saying that A is the solution to B. I'm just saying that we don't to condemn the past based on the values of the present is questionable. So not only are marriages not working out, marriage as an institution itself is being questioned and rejected by many people. So people say, okay, why do you know marry? Just live together. And even living together is now there are some legal commitments being brought together for people who live together for a long time. And they say, okay, I don't even want that. So now the result of this is that there is a lot of loneliness. Humans are not wired to be alone. Most humans are not wired to live alone. And it leads to a lot of loneliness, especially as one gets older and the obsession with making it big in the world, making one's mark in the world, especially in youth, it is very strong. When we are, say, 15, 20, 25, 30, as we go a little older, 40, 45, 50, unless one is very much driven by rajas, by the mode of passion, after that one starts thinking, okay, there has to be something more in life. And if during that time one has rejected everything else just for focusing on career, then one starts feeling a hollowness and emptiness in life, a loneliness. And beyond that, even birth rates itself are decreasing alarmingly. In most of Western society, now, when I talk about Western society, is those not just people who live in the West, but people who have internalized Western values very much, especially Western means postmodern values. Now, among them, birth rates are very, very less. There is a whole movement called antenatal movement that you should not have children. That the world is such a terrible place. Why would you bring a child into this world? Or if you bring a child into this world, this child will eventually pollute the environment. Therefore, to protect the environment, we will not have children. So the birth rate has fallen below sustainable levels. Normally, the birth rate has to be at least 2 for the population to sustain. Actually, it needs to be a little more than 2. Because not everybody who is born lives to continue the generation. People may die in their childhood, their teens. So if at all right now the population in the West has, the population itself has not gone below sustainable levels, that's because of immigration from other countries and other parts of the world where these values are not so common. But even immigrants from Asia or other places, when they come, after some time, they also internalize these values. So, ironically, you could say, to some extent, the only people who are procreating above the necessary reproductive level are religious people. So religious people, whether they're Christians or Muslims or Hindus not so much, but primarily Christians and Muslims. So they are reproducing above the high level. So there are some atheists who are expressing an alarm that atheism may win an intellectual victory by proving how religion is foolish, but atheism may suffer a demographic loss. And they are saying, you know, we should reproduce. But the problem is that within the materialistic worldview, if the purpose of life is simply to enjoy, then having children seems to be like a big burden. Even committing to a long-term relationship, for some people, it seems the price is not worth the reward. So these are big sociological issues. And I'm just making some, you could say, broad assessment statements. Each of these statements could be nuanced. The emphasis of what I'm saying is that if we just reject the values of the past, well, the alternative that we have created itself has serious problems, even from a material perspective. We're not here talking about, oh, this is not conducive for people's spiritual growth. That is a faraway discussion. Even from a literal material, sustainable survival perspective, there are issues. So now, why are marriages being questioned? Why are marriages not working? So it's ironic that romance and romantic relationships and having love in our relationships that is emphasized so much, but that has that has not translated into sustainable relationships or loving relationships. I think there was an article some time ago in one of the prominent papers, and I think it was on New York Times or somewhere, that how America fell out of love with romance. What they meant is that if we consider entertainment industry as a parameter of what people aspire for. So it seems that sci-fi movies and action movies and action heroes and that kind of thing is far more popular than even romance and romantic movies and romantic novels. Of course, there is a lot of demand for that also. But the point is that the idea that we can have happy relationships, that is, it is a dream, it's an aspiration, but the reality is often too harsh. So why is that happening? There could be, again, many, many reasons. But so my thread of thought over here is that we are discussing that when Dushyanta is, the king Dushyanta is saying that I'll not be attracted to somebody outside my social group. We may think, oh, isn't this a terrible restriction on one's finding a good life partner and being happy in life? Isn't that a restriction? So the point here which I'm making is that maybe we are expecting too much from one relationship. So what has happened is there is a glamorization, or you could say over-glamorization, through romantic novels and romantic movies. Although I said they've relatively, they have decreased slightly, but still they are hugely there even now. So the male-female relationship of that finding Mr. Right or Miss Right, finding one's dream partner, is seen as the purpose of life. I've written a book on reincarnation, and I often speak on this topic of reincarnation. And I explain philosophically how the soul goes from one body to another body. And quite often, especially among college students, when I give a talk on reincarnation, a common question that comes up is, how can I find my soulmate? So I often say that, you know, maybe you should focus first on understanding the soul, then think of finding your mate. So reincarnation also has been romanticized, sensationalized. And the philosophical concept that we live after this life and that we need to create a trajectory for us that is bright in the future beyond this life, that aspect of reincarnation is lost. And just the idea of how can I find a partner with whom I can be there life after life. So the idea that this one relationship, if I can just find, that will make me happy in my life. And if I don't have that, if anybody interferes with that, then that is a recipe for misery. So we may be expecting too much from relationship, from that one relationship. And what has happened is we have a nuclear family structure. So of course, now even nuclear family is breaking apart and we just have electrons and protons orbiting in the concrete jungles of today, unfortunately. But even when if we assume that nuclear families, what happens is there is too much expectation from one person, one's partner. And in the traditional settings, there were other supportive relationships which might come from one's extended family, from one's community, or even within one's professional setting. So nowadays with so much mobility, people seek upward mobility, but a mobility also means instability. So people even change jobs very frequently. So even in their offices with their colleagues, they're not really forming any deep relationships. In the family, they may not have relationships. I mean, not even have possibility for relationship with the extended family. So what happens is, on one side, we have a glamorized idea of what the marital relationship should offer or will offer. And then we are living in a socio-economic setting where other supportive relationships are very much unavailable. And that creates too much pressure on this one relationship. And then naturally, it's a setup for disappointment, for heartbreak, for frustration. So So what can we do? So here transcendence, that when there is a higher purpose to life, when finding one's perfect life partner is not considered the purpose of life, there is a higher, a transcendental purpose to life, then acceptance of a reasonably compatible partner, that okay, this is the social system, these are whatever structures I have, whatever resources I have for deciding a partner, we can accept that a little more easily. So when we are focused on a transcendental purpose, then what happens is it becomes easier to accept boundaries on desires that may otherwise divert us away from transcendence. So just the search for a perfect partner, if that becomes my obsession in life, then I may go to any extremes in seeking that. But if I understand life has a higher purpose, now of course, my relationships in this world matter, but that is not going to give me ever perfect fulfillment. So if I can accept certain boundaries, I might not get the perfect partner, but if I get a reasonably compatible partner, that's okay. So it doesn't seem repressive. So Vishwanatha Thakur used the example of how a higher purpose or a higher value can help us restrain our desires. So he says that suppose somebody is resolved that they're going to fast from grains on a sacred day like Ekadashi. Now, because they're saying, I'll focus on spiritual cultivation, I want to elevate myself. If that is their understanding, then even if they see some food with grains, they won't feel attracted to it. Okay, I'm not going to take it. They'll just notice it and move on from it. Not today. So we could say Dushman's desire is like that. He's saying that, okay, the purpose of life is dharmic, spiritual elevation. So if he's not saying I have to be a celibate for that, but if his mind has become cultured in such a way that, okay, my attraction will go towards a member of my own varna, my own social group. So that acceptance of the boundary doesn't seem repressive if there is a higher purpose to life. And this is where training our desires comes in. So when we focus our desire on something bigger, if we realize our soul's potential for eternal loving the Lord, we realize our own spiritual essence, then what happens is other things won't hold sway on us. They won't hold power on us as our defining desires. So finding a dream partner won't remain as our life mission. And insisting on our autonomy to choose whoever we want without any considerations, that won't be such a big issue for us. So the training of desires is not repressing of desires. It is directing the power of desires somewhere higher. So broadly, what is the carry home we can take from here? So regulation of our worldly desires, it won't seem repressive when we direct the power of desire toward a higher path, a higher purpose. So in today's world, how traditionally the purpose of arranged marriages was to provide such a path and purpose for one's desire. Unfortunately, whether we consider tradition or whether we consider modernity or postmodernity, that higher purpose is not always prominent. In fact, we could say it's rarely prominent. So tradition may impose too much rigidity. Postmodernity may demand too much autonomy. But rather than debating between this or that, we can focus on how can I direct the power of my desire toward a higher purpose in life. That higher purpose is ultimately to develop our relationship with Krishna. He is the ultimate object of love. He is our perfect partner. And of course, going towards him is a long journey, and we need relationships in this world. But if we don't, we are not over-expecting and over-demanding from the relationships in this world, then once we have those priorities straight, then regulating our desires, being able to accept whatever relationships we are able to form, that will become relatively easier. That won't seem repressive. Rather, that will be seen as supportive for our higher purpose in life. So I'll summarize. I discussed broadly 3 points today. First was that Dushmant, when he's regulating his desire, and he's saying that my mind is naturally trained to not seek a partner from any other varna beyond kshatriya. That is not due to any bias against any varna. And he's not saying this is something which everybody has. It's more a personal claim rather than a universal imposition. But the idea is that is not due to any bias necessarily. That is more due to it. A same social group would lead to increased probability of compatibility. And that was a supportive aid for finding a compatible partner. And then if we look at the past through our prisms, we impose modern emphasis on autonomy on traditional settings, and whether it is sacred literature or even classical literature from the West, we will find it filled with questionable things. So we don't have to have historical imperialism. We can't turn the clock back, but we don't have to impose our values on the past and reject the past. And what is the alternative? So we discussed that the purpose of marriage and relationships is to ultimately get on with life. The relationship itself is not the purpose of life. So pre-modern, so post-modern emphasis on autonomy excessively, and pre-modern emphasis on duty and conformity excessively. So spiritually, we channelize or integrate both autonomy and duty in the pursuit of spirituality. So just the rejection of traditional restrictions has not necessarily fulfilled the dreams. We see marriages are not working, and even the institution is being questioned, and even fertility, birth rates are decreasing below sustainable levels. So the concluding principle was that when there is a transcendental purpose, when there is a higher path for the power of our desires, then regulating our desires doesn't seem repressive. Rather, it is supportive for moving forward in life. So without getting into whether this system or that system for forming relationships, what we can focus on is, first we try to give a lofty path and purpose for our power of desire, and then the appropriate boundaries for our other desires will automatically become acceptable for us. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.